Welcome to First Baptist Church of Walnut Creek. We're studying the book of Revelation.
I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles to Revelation chapter 14. That's going to be our scripture reading.
Then I looked, and behold, a white cloud, and on the cloud sat one like the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him who sat on the cloud, "Thrust in your sickle and reap, for the time has come for you to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe." So he who sat on the cloud thrust in his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped. Then another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, he also having a sharp sickle. And another angel came out from the altar, who had power over fire. And he cried with a loud cry to him who had the sharp sickle, saying, "Thrust in your sharp sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe." So the angel thrust his sickle into the earth and gathered the vine of the earth and threw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trampled outside the city, and blood came out of the winepress up to the horses' bridles for 1,600 furlongs.
Revelation 14 is going to be the conclusion of this chapter. This is the last portion of the third interlude. And then we're going to be moving on to more of the judgments. Before we get there, though, let's open in a word of prayer. Lord, we ask for your guidance. We ask for your direction. We ask you to help us to think through your word and apply it to our life. There's a lot of information that you've given to us, and we've had time to consider and think about what's going to take place in the future. And the question that we're asking ourselves is, what should we do now? Knowing what's going to take place, knowing what you are going to do. One way or the other, things are not going to change in which you're going to change your plan. Your plan is moving forward. But we know there are loved ones, family members, friends, neighbors, co-workers, people in our country that do not have a relationship with you. It is our desire that that changes. So we ask, Lord, that you work first in our own heart, causing us to want to have a desire to bring them to your word. Make us fisher of men. Again, Lord, open our eyes to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. It's hard really to comprehend the power of a nuclear bomb. Conventional weapons, in contrast, are seen in Hollywood movies on a regular basis. We see cars explode, planes blow up, or buildings are demolished. Yet when a nuclear bomb is detonated, its power is measured in the kiloton. One kiloton is equivalent to 1,000 tons of dynamite. A 100 kiloton bomb would be about 6 times larger than the bomb that was used at Hiroshima, where a third of the population was killed. At the center of a nuclear bomb, there's a fireball that vaporizes everything within the sphere. The ground actually turns to glass. The shockwave from that blast moves so fast that none of our modern-day planes can outpace it. Exterior materials on homes are removed before the building is completely crushed. Trees are stripped of their branches before they are snapped like pencils. The flash of the bomb is so brilliant that those who see it will lose their eyesight. And then you have the radiation fallout that contaminates water, food, and everything a person touches for miles, making everything around it deadly. The devastation of this bomb is nothing, though, compared to Christ. Christ is real power. Christ has the power to actually transform the very elements around us. He has the power to stop the rotation of the earth, to cause the dead to live again. The rules of science do not mean anything to him because those limitations do not apply to him. How serious is the situation of a man who stands before the wrath of Christ? Well, here we are in Revelation chapter 14. The book of Revelation is the unveiling of Christ. The world sees him not as a baby in a manger or a religious leader hanging on a cross, but as the righteous judge who is coming to pass judgment. He is not holding a little hammer in his hand. Oh no. He's holding something far more threatening. He holds a sickle in his hand. Chapter 14 opens like a modern day electronics store that you walk into. When you walk in, you can't help but notice there are screens everywhere, and your attention is drawn from screen to screen. So the picture that you see when you first walk in, at one screen you see 144,000 people that are singing. And then immediately you look at another screen and you see there's an eternal gospel that's being presented on another screen. And then you look, there's another screen and there's a huge fall of a city that's collapsing. And then you look at another screen and there is a bunch of people who are being judged. And then there's another screen and there's a man who's a king and he has a sickle in his hand. And then you see another screen and it looks like grapes are being harvested, but it can't be grapes because it's not grapes that are being squeezed and squeezed out. It's blood that's flowing. So today our attention is drawn to the very last two screens. The pictures are of those who are farming the earth and farming grapes. So our outline is going to be kind of simple. First, reaping the earth's harvest, and then second, reaping the grapes of wrath. These two pictures really illustrate the same judgment that's taking place. The first picture emphasizes the speed or the completeness of the judgment. And the second really emphasizes the terror or the impact of the judgment. So we're going to begin with the very first picture, reaping the earth's harvest. The picture of the harvest judgment is very common in the Bible. And I know you're in the book of Revelation, but I'm going to ask you to go back into the Old Testament. Go until you find Joel. Joel chapter 3. Now, if you come across to Ezekiel or Isaiah, you need to stop going left and start going right again because you've gone into the major, and Joel is called a minor prophet. Although there's nothing that he says in here that's minor at all. But when you find it eventually, of course, you can use your index in your Bible. That's a nice little cheat sheet. It's not cheating. It's really just helping you get there quicker. But Joel chapter 3, verse 12 and 13, you see that God uses the analogy or the illustration of a harvest as a normal process of explaining judgments. Basically, because everybody in every culture, rich or poor, understand, and even in our culture today, we understand harvest. We understand that. We may not work it. We may not go out and pick the field anymore, but we understand there is a season that comes to harvest. So, in Joel chapter 3, verse 12, he says, "Let the nations be wakened and come to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there I will sit to judge all the surrounding nations. Put in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, go down, for the winepress is full, the vats overflow, for their wickedness is great." So you can see the connection between Joel and Revelation, can't you? Let's see the judge of the harvest. Let's turn back to Revelation chapter 14. The judge of the harvest, in verse 14, is familiar to you. If you've been here at any time and you've been faithful coming to church, you're going to recognize, oh, I know who this is. Verse 14 says, "Then I looked," we know who the I is, it's John, "and behold, a white cloud." Wait a minute, so the judge is on this white cloud. How interesting, isn't it, the white cloud is there? Who ascended into heaven in a white cloud? Who promises to return for the bride in a white cloud? In Daniel chapter 7, verse 13, Daniel says, I was watching in the night vision, and behold, one like the Son of Man, coming with clouds of heaven, and he came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. The same one, he's coming in a cloud. And Daniel talks about the Son of Man. And John here also sees one like the Son of Man. The Son of Man is the same person that we've seen earlier on in Revelation chapter 1, verse 13. Remember, in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man, clothed with the garment down to his feet and girded about the chest with golden bands. He's wearing a golden crown also. Now that golden crown is called a Stephanos. It means he's a victor. It's that victory crown that he's wearing. It's the symbol of one who has won. And this is the symbol of, yes, Christ also wears a diadem, which means he is a ruling leader. But Christ is the victor. He is overcome. And that's what it's pointing to here. And in his hand is a sickle. In harvest times, it was really interesting that people would take and use things like this. And you've seen these, maybe on the Grim Reaper, since we're so close to Halloween. But this is one of the tools that they would use, and they would reap the ground, right? So, but this is not what they're talking about. If you're old-fashioned and you like to do lots of exercise, you could weed eat with this. Okay, all right, there you go. This would be more in line of what we're talking about you're using. This is a sickle in which the material is held in this hand, and then it's cut. So if you just want to take a head of grapes or a head of wheat, you've got them in one hand, and you can control your cut. You know exactly where you're cutting. So here we have a person who has a crown, and in one hand he has this. Now, mine is all rusty. You can tell it has not been used. The one that's here is nice and shiny and sharp. Okay. So keep that in your mind. The tool is a curved blade, which you see. It's mostly used for cutting grass. It's that specific tool for cutting the piece of fruit or part of the harvest in which you want a certain material from it. Once you start cutting, though, you can't change it. You can't make a correction. Once the arm starts swinging, the act is final. This is the tool that the Son of Man is using in judgment. The act of the sickle, again, is final. So who is this judge? You know who it is. It's none other than Christ. It is he who sits on this cloud and who has a sickle in his hand. It is he who is going to judge the nations. But let's take a look at the harvest. For the harvest, the condition of the harvest is important for us. And verse 15 says, then another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him who sat on the cloud, thrust in your sickle and reap, for the time has come for you to reap. The harvest of the earth is ripe. Well, right off the bat, we should say, some have taken this passage to see that there is a dual harvest here, meaning that there are those who are harvested to heaven and the wicked are sent to hell. But the passage seems to focus solely on the ungodly. And that's really how I take it and see it also. The announcement is sent by God through an angel to Christ. This is the time. All right, let us begin. God's plan has finally come. And Christ is entreated to begin his judgment. The word ripe that's found here means to become dry or withered. It has a bad connotation when it's used. It's never used in a positive manner. And that's really where we're going to take a little bit of time, and I want you to see that. And then I'll explain why for just a moment. So I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 21. We're going to go through the New Testament just a little bit. I want you to see, again, how this word is used. It's important to understanding whether this is talking about a dual harvest or a single harvest. And again, I'm pushing, I think it's a single harvest. It's referring to harvest of the wicked. You're in Matthew chapter 21, verse 19. It really boils down to how the word ripe is being used. In Matthew chapter 21, verse 19, it says this, "And seeing a fig tree by the road, he came and found nothing on it but leaves, and said to it, 'Let no fruit grow on you ever again.' Immediately the tree withered away." That's that word. Same word that's referred here as ripe. "And the disciples," verse 20, "they saw it and they marveled, saying, 'How did the fig tree wither away so soon?'" The word's being used there, you see in the contrast, it's talking about something that is not ready to produce, but looks like it's dying. Let's go to Mark. Next gospel over, Mark chapter 3. Mark chapter 3. Verse 1. "He entered the synagogue again, and a man was there with a withered hand." Now we're not talking about fruit, we're actually talking about a human limb. And in verse 3, "And he said to the man who had the withered hand," again, same situation, withered hand. It's not referring to something that is full and ripe and ready. It's talking about something that is past due. You're still in Mark. Go to Mark 11, verse 20. Mark 11, verse 20. "Now in the morning, they passed by and they saw a fig tree dried up from its roots." Dried up from its roots. Same word as withered. Same word in Revelation as ripe. It's that idea. It's past due. Now, you're in Mark. I want you to go to Luke. Luke chapter 8, verse 6. Luke 8, verse 6. This is in that parable of the sower and the seeds. Verse 6 says, "And some fell on the rock, and as soon as it sprang up, it withered away because it lacked moisture." Again, same word. Now we're going to skip all the way over to James. Go to James. Find Hebrews. Go one more book over. James chapter 1, verse 11. "For no sooner had the sun risen with a burning heat, then it withers the grass, its flowers fall, and the beauty appearance perishes. So the rich man will fade away in his pursuits." Same word, wither. Now, let's go all the way back to Revelation. Skip chapter 14, head to 16. 16:12. "And the sixth angel pours out his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and the water was dried up." Every time this word in the Greek is used, the connotation is always referring to that which not is ripe and prepared, because when we think of the word that's ripe, we think of that which is ready and prepared to eat. If I sent you into the store and say, "Get me a ripe tomato," and you brought home a tomato that was all withered, shriveled, we would not even cut it. We would just throw it away because there's something wrong with it. It's bad. Or pick any other fruit. But that's the phrase that's here. Now, why every translation has stuck with the idea of ripe, I do not know. But if we go back to chapter 14, looking at this, and we talk about the same phrase in verse 15, I'm in the wrong passage. Here we go. If we go back and we look at 15, it says, "Another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice to him who sat on the cloud, 'Thrust your sickle in and reap, for the time has come for you to reap, for the harvest of the earth is past due,'" or "the harvest is withering." You see how that makes a lot more sense. It fits better. Because when a harvest is past due, it needs to be cleaned out. You don't let fruit sit on the tree. You've got to clean it out. You don't let fruit, I shouldn't say fruit, but vegetables, sit in the field. You've got to clear it all out. You've got to pull it all off the field. Because if it sits and rots, rotting produces disease. So what has to take place? The bad stuff has to go. There has to be a cleansing. And the announcement is, it is time to clean the earth. Christ has come. The harvest, it is time to clean up. And that is what Christ is doing. And we see the speed of the harvest. Verse 16. So he who sat on the cloud thrust his sickle in the earth. I mean, the picture is just this. Thunk. You got the big round ball. Thunk. And it's done. You don't have a big production. You don't have a whole lot of a big make to do of anything. You just have Christ who is plunging the sickle in, and it's reaped. The earth was reaped, it says. It's done. So, that being the case, Christ is clearly the one that's in complete control. He is the ultimate authority of the judgment. We should not be surprised that he ever uses angels either. That is a normal thing that he uses. Here, in verses 17 through 20, we're going to see that he uses angels as a normal process of his judgments. And we're going to turn to Matthew, back to Matthew 13 a little bit. But I don't want to move away from the idea that this judgment is quick. It does not take him long to judge the world. Again, the sickle is just plunged into the earth and it's over. Some people think that God has not given man enough time to change. But that's not true. Over and over again throughout the Bible, we have example after example of God giving people more than enough time. Remember, he gave the Amorites 400 years to turn from their sin. He states that when he's talking to Abraham. Abraham, your descendants are going to go into slavery in Egypt before they come into land, to give the Amorites time. Their sins are not fulfilled yet. They have a chance to turn from their sin, and they don't. Here in the Great Tribulation, we have another 7 years that mankind has a chance to turn from his wickedness. But instead, he becomes more wicked, if that's even possible. And he chooses to rebel against God even further. Seeing the clear example and knowledge that God does exist, he instead says, I reject that fully. I want nothing to do with that. So when judgment comes, there is no stopping it. It is fatal and it is final. So the second picture that we see, moving from the earth's harvest, we have a picture of a grape harvest. And this is the same harvest, but we see it in the actions of what the angels are doing. We have the reaping of the grape harvest. From verse 17 through 20, we need to also remember that this is a final harvest. I cannot stress enough that this is final. There's nothing else after this. So let's begin doing the same thing. Look at the servants of the harvest. The servants of the harvest in verse 17, another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, and he also had a sharp sickle. So the angel comes from the presence of God. Who is in the temple? We know that from passing the book of Revelation. God is in the temple in heaven. And so those who are coming out of the temple, God is there. And it's also important for us to recognize that this angel is using the same tool, the tool of judgment, in this process of a final judgment. The sickle is going to cut things down and it's going to be done. It's going to clean up the mess that's on the earth. It's going to be over. Why does God do this? Or why is God using these servants? These are servants who are going to follow his instruction clearly. Look at the condition of the harvest. Verse 18 says, another angel came out from the altar who had power over the fire, and he cried with a loud voice to him who had the sharp sickle, saying, thrust your sharp sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe. Well, The vineyard of God is always designed to produce righteousness. Think about that just for a moment. The vineyard that God has planted has always been to produce righteousness. Not weeds, righteousness. Turn back into the Gospel of John, John 15. Perhaps your mind can't help but think of whenever we talk about the vine, your mind perhaps goes to John 15. If it doesn't, it should. This is that great passage in which Jesus is talking about himself. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. I love that. You're already bearing some fruit, but he's going to cut on you to get more. So the cutting does not feel great, but it is necessary to produce more, because he knows what he's doing. He knows what he's doing with his creation in order for them to produce more godliness. Right? So the trials and the tribulations that we find ourselves in, they are not accidents. They are not mistakes. God is not lost. We can't say, God, where are you? Why have you abandoned me? I'm all alone. I don't understand what I'm going through right now. We follow this analogy or this illustration. We're looking at, wait a minute. God knows exactly what he's doing. He's doing these things to produce more godliness. Say, but I don't understand. It's not about understanding. It's about producing more fruit. Hopefully we will understand more. But there's a lot of things that take place in our lives that we don't understand. If you ever went into the military, you would not understand the purpose of boot camp. Especially the first 3 days. I never went to boot camp. I know some did. It's not something they speak fondly of. Going to school. When you went to school, how many of you said, what is the purpose of math? I'll never need this. Right? Sure. Or some other subject that you've had to take. I'm never going to need this. And maybe you never did need this. Or maybe you found out you really did need it. So, there are many things that are like that. Let's continue on in chapter 15 in John. He says, you are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit in and of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bear much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. So every time we think we can do it all without Christ, we end up doing absolutely nothing. The only time we produce anything that remarks of godliness is when we are actually abiding in him, yielding to him, following him. Verse 6 says, if anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they're burned. If you abide in me, and my word abides in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. A branch can only produce fruit if it stays, if it abides in the vine. The branch has got to stay. Think of a tree. The branch has got to stay connected to the tree, or it's no good. What happens if the branch does not abide in the tree or the vine? It's firewood. It doesn't produce fruit. The announcement to begin the harvest parallels the announcement above, back in Revelation. But here we have angels are the ones that are involved doing all this. And we see one of the angels comes. He's in charge of the fire. Most likely, he's the one that we found back in chapter 8 in Revelation. The one who was involved with the incense and offered up the incense with the prayers of the saints. And there's probably a great chance that you remember the saints back in chapter 6 who were crying out, asking God, Lord, how long will this continue as they are being killed off for the testimony of Christ? And they're given a white robe and told to be patient for a little bit longer. Most likely this is the answer to that. The harvest has come. The time is up for everyone. And so the angels cry out with a loud voice, let the harvest begin. And the harvest is fully ripe. Fully ripe here is not the same word that's used above. Fully ripe, and you've seen this too, fully ripe means bursting with fruit. You've touched fruit that's so ripe that it just breaks open and juice runs out of it. If you haven't done that, you've seen fruit that is ripped open. You think there's something wrong with it. It's just overripe. There's so much pressure on the inside, the skin can't contain it. And that's what's happening here. The vineyard of the earth produces wickedness. Paul talks about this in different terminology. Paul talks about the fruit of the Spirit and the works of the flesh. He says, by each, by what is produced in each, you will know it, because that's what it's yielding to. The works of the flesh, or fruit, if you will. He says, now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I've warned you before, that those who do, or make this their practice, such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. When the Christian inspects his or her life and finds these things there, it's time for us to begin to ask ourselves, am I abiding in Christ if this is there? If this is how I am known, or if this is my practice, it is time for some pruning to take place, because God will not allow this to be in our life if we are abiding in Him. If any of these things are among you, it is now time, brothers and sisters in Christ, it is time for us to pick them out and remove them and start our yielding to Christ. Right? Because the condition of the harvest needs to be one in which is going to bear righteousness, not unrighteousness. Take a picture of the harvest here. Back in Revelation chapter 14, verses 19 and 20. The fruit is gathered into the winepress of the wrath of God. He says, so the angel thrust his sickle into the earth, and he gathered the vine of the earth, and they threw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. So here we have the wicked are gathered to face the wrath of God. And the wrath of God has been anticipated to fall on the ungodly. This is not something in which has been continually, well, it's not going to happen. It's been anticipated from clear back in the Old Testament. In fact, in Isaiah 63, let me turn there and find that real quick. Isaiah 63, verses 1 through 6, it says, who is it that comes from Edom? Who dyes the garments of Bozrah? This is the one who is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength. I speak in righteousness, mighty to save. Why is your garment apparel red? Why is it your garment like one who treads the winepress? And it says, I have treaded the winepress alone, for from the people no one was with me. I have trodden them in my anger. I have trampled them in my fury. Their blood is sprinkled upon my garments. I have stained all my robes. For the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of my redeemed has come. I looked, and there was none to help, and I wondered that there was no one to uphold. Therefore, by my own arm, brought salvation for me, and by my own fury it sustained me. I have trotted down the people in my anger, and I made them drunk in my fury, and brought them down their strength to the earth. It's clear back in the Old Testament. That's hundreds and hundreds of years before this portion of Scripture was ever even written. And yet, the ancient winepress were exactly the same. Ancient winepress were just material that was hewed out of rocks. You tended to have two that were like that. You had one that was a massive stone that was cut out, and then you would take the grapes and toss them into there. And then you had a second one that after the overflow of the grapes would pour in. So, after you got all your grapes thrown into that, you would have someone that would stand up and go into it, and they would just do this all the time. In their bare feet, squishing the grapes. And as the grapes were crushed, that juice would flow over and then pour into the second basin. Then that was ready for consumption. With toe jam included. No, that's not. But you get the idea. All of that was the squeezing of the grapes, and that's how it was produced in the ancient days. They didn't have big machines crushing all the stuff down, but that's kind of the filtering method also. All right. It's also important for us to notice that this judgment takes place not in the city of Jerusalem. It states that it's outside the city of Jerusalem. This overall judgment is known as the judgment of Armageddon. The impact of this judgment spreads. In verse 19 it says, "And the angel took his sickle into the earth, or thrust his sickle into the earth, and he gathered the vines of the earth, and he threw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trampled outside the city." Now the whole image changes. "And the blood came out of the winepress up to the horse's bridle for 1,600 furlongs. You see, the impact of this spreads over approximately 184 miles. There's some debate on how long a furlong is. But regardless, the impact is huge. The blood flows over a long distance. And blood splattering up to a horse's bridle, well, if you ride horses, you get the idea how high that is. It's about 4.5 feet. The results, this is what happens to the enemies of God. The blood of the enemy of God will flow in vast amounts, and it will cover the garments of Christ. We'll turn forward just a little bit to chapter 19. Chapter 19, verse 15, so we can see this is actually happening. It says, "Now out of his mouth goes a sharp two-edged sword, and with it he should strike the nations, but he himself will rule them with a rod of iron, and he himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of the Almighty God." The battle belongs to the Lord. And since this is really no battle at all, it is just his judgment on evil. The wicked actions of men who refuse the truth for a lie, who refuse the grace of God and instead would prefer the grave, that is their choice. So what do we do with this information? Or maybe what should we do with this information from Revelation 14. That's sort of the challenge that as believers in Christ we're faced with. What do we do when we hear about the judgment of Christ is coming and it's going towards unbelievers? It'd be easy to sit back and go, "Yay, they deserve it." But when we look back and we see how terrifying it is, how horrific it is, we take an evaluation, we know that some of those people are our own loved ones that are going to have to face him. And that's tough. It's going to be our people that we work with. We wouldn't want that to happen to them. It's going to be neighbors. It's going to be people that we know. It's going to be our country. That should be hard for us. if it's not hard for us, maybe our hearts aren't right with him. Because we are called to love one another as he loved us. God does not desire for any to feel the impact of his wrath. He doesn't desire for any to perish. But he wants everybody to come to repentance. How will people know in the day and age that we live in, know about the message of God unless there's somebody to bring it? I know we live in a different world. I know that technology is all around us. But again, somebody has to bring the message. Technology is cold. We are warm. I don't know if technology is good or bad unless I have someone who says, this is what I've been using and it works great. Now I'm interested in using it. Because you first used it. So in a sense, how do I know Christ is real? How do I know he is able to save me from my sins? How do I know if he will give me eternal life? Only because if it's real in your life. How will people know if he really does love them unless they first see it through us? The unsaved will only see the love of God through his children. Not on a billboard, not on a mass mailing, not on some sign. And you know that's true. We've got to invite people to hear the word of God. We've got to invite people into a relationship with Christ. That's us. That's not a thing. We got to step out of our comfort zones. I'm going to ask you to do that. I'm going to ask you to step out of your comfort zone. I understand it's hard, but if you don't, who will? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your truth that never changes. We know you judge rightly. We know you are true. And we thank you for your love for us. But Lord, we lift up individuals who come to our mind right now who we're not sure that they have a relationship with you. We're a little nervous or not sure how to approach that. But Lord, we just ask that you'd give us boldness. Help us to create a path to just talk about you or to invite them to hear about you because we love them. Maybe that's the first place we just need to start with them, is to say, hey, I love you and I want to introduce you to somebody who loves you too. Your word here that we have been studying in Revelation, it's final, Lord, and we get that, and that has been ringing loud and clear. The time is growing short for all of us. But we definitely want to be found serving you when you come. Thank you, Lord, for using broken tools like us for your honor and glory. You don't have to, Lord, and we just thank you for glorifying yourself in this manner. We pray for these things in Jesus' name. Amen.